Recorded Books presents Blown by the Same Wind by John Straley. Narrated by T. Ryder Smith. From My Argument with the Gestapo by Thomas Merton. I am carried away by the same wind that blows all these people down the street like pieces of paper and dead leaves in all directions. Chapter 1. How to Do Good in the World. It was late spring of 1968, and the abbot of Gethsemane was shaken to the core of his faith. The visit from the FBI agent had given him the final shove he needed to make the dreaded decision, and with that in mind, he sent for the monk to be brought in. The strong man, the now famous Ryder, came in wearing his work clothes, and for all the world he looked like a sunburned laborer from the fields. The abbot bade him to sit, and then he explained that he very much approved of the brother's travel plans to Alaska, California, and the Orient. He told the brother about the visit from the FBI agent with the unusual name, though he didn't mention Boston Corbett's name, nor the subject of their discussion. It weighed heavy on the abbot's heart that one of his own flock was being investigated as a radical anti-American subversive. Still, he didn't break the FBI agent's confidence. The abbot told the tired man, who had just come in from the fields, that even though his writing had brought a great deal of attention to the abbey, this kind of attention from law enforcement was troublesome. And even though he had all faith that the brother was being guided by compassion and the love of God, the abbot wanted the brother to consider a longer absence from the abbey, that perhaps with time and prayer in the wilderness, he could come back to the Brotherhood of the Cistercians. He would always be a brother of the order, but he should consider moving to the new state of Alaska until his heart was settled. The brother kept his head bowed as he listened. He and the abbot were no strangers to argument. The abbot did not often understand the brother's need to expose so many of his worldly opinions in his writing, but the brother was strong and clearly very experienced. Having come to Christ late in life and grown up with an artistic father in France and England, the brother had a more sensualist worldview than most who were called to the order. If anything, he understood issues of man and culture better than most. His pride was what worried the abbot. There was something in the abbot's tone that made it clear that the brother was receiving a well-considered recommendation, and this was not an invitation to argue.
Some time alone, perhaps in this place you've been talking about, Cold Storage, Alaska, would be best, the abbot said. A place where your fame and political opinions have not quite blossomed.
He paused and stared at the monk now in a way that left volumes unsaid, but was perfectly understood. The brother patted his dirty hands on the knees of his jeans, then got up slowly with a grimace of pain, and left. The brother went from there and drove the old station wagon several hours through the night to Bowling Green, where the young nurse, whom he had come to love, was waiting for him. M, as he'd referred to her, had cared for him after his back surgery and was staying in a downtown hotel. She was smart and sensitive, and she loved him without restraint. As was prearranged, they met alone in his psychiatrist's office. When he told her he was leaving Kentucky, possibly forever, there were tears and passionate kisses that thrilled him and filled him with guilt. Then he said goodbye. Forever. He drove back to the abbey in the dark, taking a back road so he could be alone with his thoughts. The headlights of the heavy station wagon tunneled through the darkness. As he reached one of the last crossroads before coming to the unlighted lane leading to the abbey, he saw a barn burning on the hillside. The structure seemed to be rising into the sky on wings, flames flapping up and out between the boards. The smoke resembled a cumulus cloud with a belly that glowed like a shark's. He stopped and got out, wondering for a moment if there was something he could do, but in his heart he knew there wasn't. He saw the tiny figures of people running in front of the light. Soon there would be fire trucks and volunteers from all over the region. Soon there would be relief, and eventually a barn raising. But he would be in Alaska by that time. He was on the side of the road as a dozen cars sped past him, turning toward the fire, the brigade of friends and volunteers rushing toward the danger, all for the sake of a neighbor. He stood at the hinges of his car door, watching the inexplicable flames and the response of others. His lips moved in silent prayer, asking God to have mercy on his sinner's soul. Brother Lewis was in his early 50s. Looking back on this moment from the future, you might be tempted to think that the brother had been aware of his circumstances, fully aware he was just beginning the last 8 months of his life, that he would be found dead on a distant floor before Christmas. But there was still so much more for him to do, and God had not given Brother Lewis that specific gift of foresight. Also unknown to either the abbot or Brother Lewis, there was revolution in the air, even in cold storage Alaska, although the revolution itself still lay in the distant horizon. The little fishing town had a few television sets, but there was no broadcast or cable television, so it was hard to see it coming. But marijuana, long hair on young men, and strange clothes had started to appear with the crews of some fishing boats. In 1967, Life magazine had done a story about life in cold storage, and people were now coming to visit. Ellie Hobbs and Slippery Wilson had moved up from their original cabin down the inlet and had relocated 7 old cannery cabins to the hill behind Ellie's bar, which they were renting out to tourists. Slippery was taking some of the tourists out on fishing trips, and Ellie's niece, Annabelle, would fly them up to lakes in the mountains around the area in one of her 2 float planes. The town itself had 1 restaurant, and Ellie's would feed breakfast to guests and a few sandwiches at the bar or send some out in the fishing boat. For special high-paying guests, Ellie provided dinner. At night, her guests would eat either at the restaurant down the boardwalk or in Ellie's establishment for an additional charge. That first year of 68, the cabins were about a quarter full, and that was fine with everybody involved. Annabelle had a 3-year-old boy named Clive, and she sometimes hired girls from up and down the raised plank walkway to watch him, because she was scared to death that the little boy would tumble off the plank street and crack his head open on the rocks below. He always had on his old orange life jacket, which was as bulky as a parachute on him, and Slippery suggested Clive wear his old infantryman's helmet, but the child would not countenance it. The town itself was busy in the summer. The cannery was up and running, and boats were lined up at the dock many days to unload fish to be cleaned, canned, and shipped out. The trade of flying out fresh frozen fish or fresh iced down fish to restaurants was an experiment that was just being considered in places with more boats and better plane service. But the fishermen knew the day would come when prices climbed and people got the taste for fresh salmon and halibut. College kids from the lower 48 still worked cutting fish, and they played the new music in their rooms at night. Some were smoking pot in the woods, and this had some of the old people upset. The boys grew their hair longer than most people were used to, and they had to use hair nets at the cannery. They wore mostly blue work shirts, blue jeans, and flannel jackets. The girls wore all sorts of colorful clothes, both at work and off. Mexican blouses and tie-dye skirts, Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club band and surrealistic pillow records came in on float planes, and the music washed over the air along with patchouli oil and marijuana on summer Sundays. Boys who dressed in green army jackets and wore ponytails hanging down their backs walked down the boardwalk with their arms around girls wearing capes, halter tops, and bell-bottoms, turning the heads of the World War II vets who ran wooden schooners and had heard the stories of free love and endless drugs coming from Southeast Asia. There had been four instances that summer when someone had broken into a building and stolen a small amount of money and a few items of sentimental value to the owners. Burglary was unknown in town before that summer of 1968, and most of the old people figured it had been brought to town by the new workers at the cannery. They were not just boys with long hair and girls who didn't wear brassieres, but two African-American men working at the cannery who immediately jumped to the top of the suspect list. There was still no road into or out of cold storage, but somehow, in 1968, the world had arrived. In March, Lyndon Johnson announced that he had decided not to run for president. Some said it was because of the Tet Offensive in the first part of the year. Boys from cold storage had gone to the war, and three of them had died. Two native boys, Charlie Pete and Alex Todd, had been shot on the same afternoon, trying to secure a landing area after being dumped on the ground by a helicopter. And a white boy named Wilson Whitman died when his jet went down, though his parents waited for years to learn if he had been captured. The bodies of Privates Pete and Todd were brought back home on a military barge from Juneau. Captain Whitman's body was never found. All the boys had fished with their families and were memorialized on a hill off the road to the dump. Glenn Andre came back in early spring. He had gone into the army to learn how to repair radios, and somehow ended up being a door gunner on a helicopter. He had been a funny kid you could always count on for a joke or a favor when you needed it. Slippery Wilson would always call him if he needed a strong back for the day, and he would show up with a smile and an extra sandwich to share. If someone was sick, Glenn would ask after them, even as a teenager. He would bring over some of his mom's cookies or some hot soup. He wasn't a show-off. He just seemed kind. Like that. Things changed when he got back in the middle of May of 1968. He was different. His hair was long, and he didn't speak much. He wore his army jacket with a bronze star pinned on the front, and he slouched at the bar by himself. He didn't have a steady job, but did odd jobs for Slippery. Some in town suspected he was committing the burglaries, simply because he always had money for a drink. Ellie spoke to him throughout the day, and if some of the old-timers tried to tease him about his hair or his drinking, she would wave them off, saying Glenn needed his space. Slippery himself had been to war and had run into deep water on Omaha Beach on D-Day, where he almost drowned with his gear on. Then dragged the body of a kid he had played cards with that morning as bullets whizzed past them into the wet sand. Others who had never seen battle said some hard things about Glenn and how he had changed. They said he had become a hippie and a coward, but Slippery would have none of that within his hearing or around his boat or crew. As far as Slip was concerned, Glenn Andre was welcome anywhere in town, no matter what length his hair was. On April 4th, somebody killed Martin Luther King Jr. It seemed like it must have been a white Southerner who shot him up on that motel balcony, but it took them a long time to catch him. There were so few black residents in cold storage, exactly none in the wintertime, and only a few when the cannery was working in the summer. Some called Alaska the most northern Southern state, and many fishermen were casually racist in their thinking. One old-time fish worker relocated to Petersburg, but then moved back quickly, saying, "Hate that town, not a white man to be found. It's almost all Norwegians and Indians." So there was mostly wide-eyed surprise at the reaction to Dr. King's murder. Ellie closed the bar and flew up to a remote lake to be away from the worst of the idle chatter after it happened. Some Arab kid killed Bobby Kennedy that June, and no one in cold storage was exactly sure why. Someone said it was because of something Kennedy said about Israel. That kid didn't make it far at all. Rosie Greer tackled him right there in the kitchen of the fancy hotel in California. This came closer to home for most of the people along the boardwalk. When Arabs start killing white men, even if they were Catholics, this was something to pay attention to. In August, the Democratic Convention in Chicago turned into a violent television show everyone watched. That's when everyone's self-righteousness started overflowing into the streets, and the hippies started calling policemen pigs. Even people in Bush, Alaska, started getting pissed off about people with long hair again. Now, all these things had an effect on village life, but none as much as the deaths of the boys in the war, or the drowning that happened in the spring when Kyle Burton's longliner went down. The weather was bad, but back then, the short openings were scheduled a long time in advance, and when the allocated fish were caught, the season ended, so people rarely stayed in on account of the weather. If you didn't go out, you were not going to make any money. Kyle went out in his old boat, and when he turned to come home, the seas broke on the stern, and the boards around his rudder opened up, sending green water to flood his engine room. His crewman got into his survival suit, but Kyle's tore open, and he died of hypothermia before help arrived. In a fishing village, this news is more real than the Chicago Seven or Sirhan Sirhan's motive for murdering a man running for president. Everyone in town could imagine the sound of the engine sputtering out. Everyone knew the smell of diesel fuel and seawater and the cracking of planking as an old boat twists into the seas. The sea insinuates itself into your dreams and into your waking. In 1968, Ellie had hosted her share of funeral receptions at her bar. She often kept the leftover flowers around for the pleasant smell. Most people brought wildflowers, or simple flowers that grew easily in their gardens next to the mountainside, rhododendrons, fuchsia, bachelor's buttons, or irises. Children sometimes would bring armloads of pussy willows if a death occurred in spring. Ellie's bar had a fine old rosewood bar and a few round tables, but there was also a 20-foot-long yellow cedar table that Slippery had made for buffets that he kept along the rear wall, where people often sat to watch the pool games near the back door. Ellie was 61 years old in 68, and she was still as strong as she had been the day in the 30s when she and her niece rode up the inside passage with Slippery Wilson and landed in Juneau during the mine strike. From there, they rode to the outer coast, where the old-timers were just building a town near a hot spring. George Hansen, the Seattle cop who had been following them up the coast, had ended up staying in cold storage as well. George had pretty much given up police work, but he served as a deputy for the federal marshals when anything had been needed in territorial days. In statehood, he still had a good relationship with the troopers, and they would let him make citizens' arrests out in the villages if anything got too frisky, and if he didn't take credit for anything important, which was fine with George. George had asked around town about the burglaries, and he, too, suspected a couple of the cannery workers. But he had no proof, and none was likely to come in the form of physical evidence, because there was no way to dust for fingerprints or get footprint impressions. The troopers did not like to waste time traveling out to the little villages to take prints from a scene that would be trampled through by almost everybody in town before the weather let them fly into the area. George just recommended that people lock their doors if they were really worried about it. But no matter how much people fretted about hippies and coloreds creeping through their houses, most people didn't bother locking up. They just kept their rifles by their beds, with one in the chamber and the safety off. Summer meant time out on the water, and George would take the burglaries seriously in the fall when the cannery workers had left town. If things went missing after that, it meant one of the locals was involved. It would be easy enough to find them when they got to drinking hard and one of their buddies snitched them off. He would then get them to return the little trinkets and pay the money back. George, however, was beginning to feel old and tired of wrestling people around, so he wasn't very hungry to make arrests or get the court system involved. He didn't want to be a cop anymore. George much preferred running his converted schooner, hauling goods up and down the coast to the little villages, bringing hay and grain to the few farmers who kept cows, and groceries to the fox farms on the islands. He had a good solid hold in his boat and a stout launch to run goods ashore when needed. Mostly, George just liked puttering up and down the coast, exploring the anchorages, dropping in a line to catch halibut, and shooting a deer from the deck when one presented itself on a near shore. He traveled with a mongrel hound dog named Dot, who slept in the wheelhouse with him and would wake him any time she heard the anchor chain dragging. Dot weighed in at around 100 pounds, which was about twice too big for a boat dog, but she was attentive and had learned to poop over the back deck and pee into the scuppers, so she was considered a good sea dog by most everyone in the fleet. She also seemed to enjoy surviving on sour milk and halibut, of which George seemed to have an endless supply. It was almost the last day of August when Annabelle walked from her small office at the harbor ramp down to Ellie's bar. She had one flight that afternoon, and wanted to check with Ellie to make sure that her passenger had a room for the night. Annabelle had been the little girl with the yellow bird when they rode up the inside passage in 1935, and they had lost the bird somewhere just north of an old cannery in British Columbia. Annabelle still missed that damn bird. It was Ellie who had been crazy about flying an airplane, and in fact Ellie had bought the first plane, the de Havilland Beaver, and had taught the girl to fly. But it was Annabelle who started Buddy's Flying Service back in 1958, when she was 31. Annabelle was 41 now, and the business was doing fine. Ellie flew for her sometimes, and she hired a couple of kids as ramp rats to carry gear and shipping supplies up and down from the dock. She also hired a full-time mechanic who lived part-time in Juneau and part-time in cold storage. Annabelle was very finicky about the planes and their upkeep. She would not let a second tick past their mandated inspection time, and she liked to keep them looking and sounding good because she knew greasy old planes scared people more than dumb-looking pilots. It was about 10 in the morning, and the bar smelled of the big pot of fresh-brewed coffee. It was the second pot, for Slippery had made the first one for his new group of fishermen, who had come in from Alabama just the day before. Glenn was sitting down at the end of the bar, his dark hair hanging down over his eyes. Ellie was playing James Taylor on the record player. "Hey, girl," Annabelle said to her aunt. She laid her ball cap on the bar, and her braids tumbled onto her shoulders. "How's business?" Ellie looked all around the bar and then back to Glenn, who was the only customer. "We are having a special today for veterans of foreign wars. Free coffee." Glenn looked up and smiled at Annabelle, then pushed his coffee cup forward for Ellie to top it. Hey, Glenn, Annabelle said. You want to come down to my office later and take a look at my single sideband radio?
What's wrong with it?
He said without much enthusiasm. I'm not really sure. I know they sound screwy normally, but it seems to be cutting in and out. And you know there are a lot of logging camps starting up, and a bunch of them need flights. I could get some money out of them while they're here. I thought I should have a good comms link with them, and none have called me yet.
You want me to look? He said in a flat voice, as if he were just waking up.
Yeah, you know, with all your government experience.
With all my government experience, I could go down to your office and shoot the radios with a 50-caliber machine gun.
He took a sip of the coffee.
Come on, Ellie. Can I have some brandy in this?
Not until noon, sweetie. Ellie smiled at him. I know you know about radios, you lunkhead. Annabelle squeezed his broad forearm.
Okay, he said.
Listen, L, I have one man flying in from Juneau this afternoon. He just gave his name as Lewis, says he's staying with you. Do you have him down?
Ellie Hobbs scanned the few names written on her new-looking register.
Yep, that's what I have. He wrote to me from a place in Kentucky. Gethsemane, Kentucky. He's some kind of religious person. He gave his name as Brother Lewis.
Huh? A priest? Annabelle said.
No,
Glenn said.
A monk, I betcha.
I'm not sure I ever met a monk, Ellie said. He wrote me a letter and said he's looking for an isolated place to stay for a while where he can write and read and be away from the rest of the world. I told him about our old cabin site.
You think he's a fugitive? Annabelle asked her aunt.
No more than we are, darling, Ellie said.
I thought you didn't care much for holy rollers, commented Annabelle, who knew almost too much about her aunt's old political views.
Ah, the old radical organizer said. I got no problem with this new breed of them if they keep their noses out of my business and aren't a bunch of temperance biddies.
Well, I just hope to Christ he has a cask of brandy with him,
Glenn said. There you go, boy, Ellie said, and she poured a shot of brandy into Glenn's coffee.
Hey, thanks, El.
Heck, it's noon somewhere.
The women laughed. Annabelle picked up her hat, tucked in her braids, waved, and headed out the door into the sunny morning. Chapter 2. Brother Lewis. Although that August of 1968 had been relatively dry, in the beginning of the third week, a slight low-pressure system moved in from the southwest with 15-mile-an-hour winds, causing moderate turbulence from sea level to 1,500 feet, but because of the clouds, the ceiling came down to 700 feet. Brother Lewis was anxious about flying. He had very little experience in small airplanes, let alone planes that took off and landed on the water. He had been disoriented ever since he left Kentucky. He had been planning this trip for 2 years, and at first he assumed it was going to be an out-and-back adventure, an opportunity to be in a remote location where he would be left alone to meditate and write, some place where his readers could not just drop in on him. But now he was not sure what he wanted. After his last talk with the abbot, he was feeling more like he had been exiled. He had traveled to Anchorage and around Juneau. He had met the nuns of the Catholic Church who spent their new lives teaching native children, yet Alaska felt forbidding. Mountains rose straight up from the sea with their rock walls and summer snowfields. The landscape was largely vertical, hard, and cold. He became more and more aware that he was a heartbroken old man, soft and warm-blooded in a world of hard surfaces. God seemed to have his hands out like a traffic cop, commanding pilgrims to stop and reconsider their path. He had imagined this as a trip to find other like-minded pilgrims, but the more he saw of the country, the more he felt like a refugee. Then there was his problem with the FBI.
They had certainly frightened his abbot, but Brother Lewis doubted the country's top law enforcement agency would follow him to Alaska.
He was not a criminal. He was a writer. Annabelle walked from behind the wooden desk she shared with other pilots in the Juneau airfield. She had some papers in her hand, and her braids still poked through her ball cap. Lewis? She stood over him.
Yes,
he said, as if waking from a troubled sleep. Good. You want to go to cold storage? This way. She pointed to a door to the airfield. She didn't wait for his answer. He simply walked behind her, as if he had no choice in the matter. The flight from Juneau was not particularly rough, but it took a bit longer because Annabelle had to stay out of the inland passages as she followed the coast down. There were just a few bumps. She looked over at the brother once she had cleared the floatplane pond, then rose up above the islands to the west. She had just the one passenger, a surprisingly handsome man with short hair who appeared to be very fit and in his early 50s. When he looked at the map, he put on his horn-rimmed reading glasses. He was wearing a plaid shirt and blue jeans under a dark navy coat. She had half been expecting a fat man in a long robe eating a big loaf of bread and chugging a jug of wine, but instead this man looked like Ken Kesey when he smiled, big shoulders and strong arms. He had only one bag and a briefcase, which he carried, and a nice-looking camera, which he used quite often during the flight. He had many questions about the islands, who lived on them, and how people survived. Annabelle did her best to answer his questions, but the engine noise made it difficult. They stopped to deliver mail and pelican, and the brother wanted to run around town for a bit, but she asked him to stay close, because they were not going to be there long. Brother Lewis snapped a few photographs and asked her how she came into the country. When she told the story of her aunt and the industrial workers of the world, about the police chasing them and the policeman staying to live alongside them in the little roadless fishing town, Brother Lewis was fascinated and could hardly contain himself from asking even more questions. Questions that Annabelle cut off by grabbing Pelican's small pouch of outgoing mail to cold storage and starting the engine. It was just a 20-minute flight down the coast to get to cold storage. Annabelle circled over the town and buzzed the boardwalk. Then she flew a bit south and circled the little harbor with the grass flats up next to the steep mountain where Slippery and Ellie's old cabin sat. This time of year there was a small coho salmon run, and two brown bears were fishing in the stream that ran near the cabin. Rain was falling now, and as the de Havilland Beaver banked hard to turn back toward town, Annabelle pointed down and yelled over the engine noise, "That's the cabin I grew up in. That's Ellie's old place she told you about." Brother Lewis took another photo and then looked up with a broad smile.
"The bears! Are they always there?"
he yelled as she pulled back on the power and leveled out, pumping the flaps.
"No," she said, "mostly just when the fish are around. They won't bother you when they are eating fish. You got a gun?"
He shook his head as if it were something he had never considered.
"We'll take care of you."
Annabelle smiled, powered down even more, and began to put the floats on the water near the harbor. Ellie's bar had a small outdoor counter built under the eaves of the roof, and the bartender could serve 5 customers seated outside while they tended the bar inside. A sliding window kept things dry when the weather blew in hard. It wasn't quite legal because the outside bar was reserved mostly for kids who were not allowed into bars any time alcohol was being served. But Ellie was sick of answering phone calls from kids asking permission for all kinds of ridiculous nonsense from their drunken parents and refused to take responsibility for passing on instructions, or worse, lying to children about their parents' wishes. So it was well known that if a child came to Ellie's any time of the day or night, they could sit outside, rap on the window, and Ellie would give them a glass of soda, and they could talk to whomever they wanted. Sometimes Ellie had cookies, for which she might charge a dime, but real store-bought candy bars went for full price. Ellie was stingy about those because she was worried about most of the kids' teeth. She cut them off after two sodas, then served them ice water and sweet cherries after that. The day Brother Lewis walked into Ellie's and set down his bag, Glenn was sitting drinking his usual coffee and brandy, wearing his army jacket, and Ellie was letting him play her newest Lovin' Spoonful album. Glenn was nodding along with Summer in the City. Sitting on a high stool at the outside bar was a 16-year-old girl who was about to turn 17. She was blonde and wore a short, neon, red and green, tie-dyed dress with a thick rope of cheap wooden beads around her neck. Her hair seemed the color of spun gold and hung down her back uncombed, but looked to be freshly washed. A person would be forgiven for being confused about how old she was, because the girl herself seemed to be confused about her age. It seemed she had grown to maturity in just a matter of weeks, yet most of her gestures and expressions were still childish. Slippery and George, who was Ellie's oldest and best friend, had recently commented on Venus's development, telling Ellie she needed to keep an eye on her before a rascal high school boy married her. Ellie had ignored them, but deep down inside, she knew there was some truth to their words. Brother Lewis, I'm Ellie Hobbs. I run the place, the bar and the cabins. My man Slippery runs the boat. I'm sure you'll be seeing him around. Good to meet you. She put her hand out, and he shook it. The brother looked down and noticed her left hand. She was missing two fingers completely and half of her middle finger. He couldn't help wincing, though the stumps seemed to be healthy and well-healed. He has kind eyes, Ellie thought, but the type of tightness around them suggested he was feeling some pain.
It's very good to meet you, he said in a resonant voice.
Did he have an accent of some kind? Ellie couldn't be sure. Maybe Eastern? Maybe Southern? Maybe he was just one of those intelligent fellas. Are you the kind of brother who can stand a drink before dinner? She asked, and here Glenn looked up at him.
What are others having?
He looked around.
I'm drinking brandy, Glenn said.
I've got 7-Up,
the young woman from outside said. Brother Lewis scratched his chin and looked around.
Well, after that flight over the mountains, I'm awful tempted to have a brandy with you, friend. But I think I will have what the lady is having. But could I buy a round for everyone?
They all smiled as Brother Lewis walked over to the end of the bar, where he was close to the open window, and could get a good look at Glenn. The girl had her back to the rain just as the sun broke through the clouds. A rainbow showed over her head, and the sun glowed behind her face. It was hard not to be stunned by her looks. She had both the angelic beauty of a Renaissance painting and the earthly sensuality of a much more worldly woman, but folded in on top of all that, she had the goofy body language of a child as she spun around on the bar stool, kicking her dirty bare feet and staring at the stranger in town.
My name is Lewis,
he said, holding out his hand first to the girl and then to Glenn.
My name is Venus, the girl shouted, twisting her hair. That's my real name, too. Some people think I made it up, but I didn't. Venus, Venus Myrtle.
And she stopped her spinning to stare at him, so he could tell that her eyes were a bluish green.
I'm Glenn Andre,
Glenn said. Then he paused, looked up, and asked,
So, are you a Franciscan?
The brother smiled and said, No, I'm a Trappist brother, a Cistercian, actually, a brother of the Abbey of Gethsemane in Kentucky.
What's a brother do?
Venus called out, while Ellie put another soda in front of her. The girl was clearly excited to have an exotic visitor in town.
Is it a job? Like a priest?
She almost yelled.
Wait a minute, baby.
Remember, you can use your inside voice sitting here. He's just right close, okay? Ellie said. Venus shrugged, blushing.
Sorry,
she said, and she was.
That's all right. Yes, being a Trappist is a job. It's really one of the greatest jobs anyone can have.
What do you do? Again she almost yelled, and again she was embarrassed. What do you do? She repeated in a small voice.
We live together, and we do our best to love God. But more than that, we do our best to be happy while doing it.
Why?
Venus asked, softly this time. Because we hope if we do it successfully, if we can sustain ourselves loving God, if God sustains us and other people see how happy we are, then we hope that inspires others to love God as well.
That is so cool! Here Venus couldn't contain herself.
Oh, yeah. It's groovy,
Glenn said, picking up his brandy glass, downing it in one gulp, and putting it softly down.
It's nice work if you can get it, I suppose. I gotta be going, folks. Thanks for the drink, brother.
Then he was gone. The remaining three were silent for a moment.
He's troubled,
Ellie began to explain.
No, that's okay. I do put people off sometimes. I wasn't going to introduce myself by the name I use in the Abbey. Like I say, it puts people off, but I'm afraid I was a little charmed by your enthusiasm, Venus, which is a perfect name for you, by the way.
Thank you. Do you have another name? She asked.
I do, but I will only tell you about it later when I'm getting ready to leave. Okay?
He smiled at her and held his finger to his mouth as if he were telling her to hush. Then he turned to Ellie.
Perhaps you could show me the cabin and I could take a look around before dinner.
Thinking he would want quiet, Ellie took him to the cabin farthest from the bar, down the boardwalk, up some stairs, and down a narrow trail. At the cabin site, there was a covered porch that overlooked the inlet down toward the south, where their old cabin property was. The newer cabin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.